watching the skies, hoping for the best but expecting the worst. Are you gonna drop the bomb or not? Let us die young or let us live forever. We don't have the power, but we never say never. Sitting in a sandpit, life is a short trip. The music's for the sad man. Can you imagine when this race is won? Turn our golden faces into the sun. Praising our leaders, we're getting in tune. The music's played by the madman.
So dedicated to it?
Well, I think that, that's exactly the answer to it, because the students here at West Park realize there's a challenge involved and they rise to the occasion. So whether it takes a lot of time or not is probably not important. Probably the more time it takes, the more they're determined to do the job. It's also a lot of tradition involved.
What made you join rowing? What made you want to do it?
Well, I always liked the sport. I think it's a good sport.
Well, I saw other people row and I liked the sport. winning and then partying.
Because we like competition.
Yeah.
We like being out there.
Because it's an awesome sport.
What do you like best about rowing?
Rowing together with all eight guys in the crew. You work together as one.
The thing I like best about rowing is the dedication and devotion it takes for eight guys to win a race.
I like being out on the water, just being out there.
What do you like best about rowing?
Winning the gold.
Is on here, LeBride scores!
Again. Taylor gets set in the slot, scores! Good play. Carpenter, nice stick hand, goal, shoot, score!
The game of hockey is becoming ever more intense. The games are closer, the standings tighter. To win these days, the team must have an edge over the opposition. This brings me to the discussion of a growing concern lately on the overload of hockey violence. Hockey violence is caused by the fierce competition in the league. The desire, the frustration, and reputation of players are three major factors in the issue. Let's take the Philadelphia Flyers, for example. The Flyers have no superstars, no scoring champions. No most valuable players, yet they still manage to be one of the best teams in the NHL. How do they accomplish this? No, they don't bribe the referees. They hit, they intimidate, and they do whatever it takes to win. As Philadelphia coach Mike Keehan said,
we don't have the game-breaking Gretzky and Messi, for example. We have to do it through dogged hard work.
A big team and good goaltending. The team is stacked with players like Dave Brown, who was suspended for 15 games for this check on a New York Ranger player, and Ron Hextall, the Philadelphia netminder, who was out for 8 games earlier this season on a vicious slash like this. Players think twice before going in his crease. On the other hand, the Edmonton Oilers are an excellent example of hockey at its finest. The Oilers are known for their speed and ability. They are loaded with talent, and players realize that there are more help on the ice than in the penalty box. Take Wayne Gretzky, for example. Wayne is a threat without using his stick as a weapon. Instead, he spends his time doing what he does best, scoring goals. If the game is becoming more dangerous, the officials should put their feet down to prevent it. I think the increase of fines and the extension of penalties would make any player think twice before injuring his opponent with his lumber. The fans, however, love it. Arenas are filled to bursting with eager spectators waiting to see a bench-clearing brawl or a player carried out on a stretcher or to hear the glass shake with a bone-rattling body check. The most negative aspect of hockey violence is the effect on young people and our minor hockey leagues. Kids staying up late at night to see their hero beat up someone they don't like. They don't realize that one reason for so much misconduct is the amount of protection one gets from their equipment. Kids then start to think they're tough when they play. Sure, they're tough. They've got hundreds of dollars worth of padding on. Well, if these players are that rough, why don't they step in a few rounds with this guy? I rest my case. The best remedy for this sudden burst of lethal combat is if kids realize that to win a hockey game, you must score, not fight. If the minor as well as professional hockey leagues start influencing stiffer punishment, if the referees keep violence to a minimum, and if players start doing what they're paid millions of dollars for each season, playing hockey, we should be back to seeing some good, clean, fast, exciting hockey. Hopefully, the next time a player steps on the ice, he won't be entering a danger zone. Miss Earhart was one of the most adventurous and daring women of the 1920s and 30s. Her life ended in mystery in 1937. Amelia, or Millie, was born on July 24, 1898, in Atkinson, Kansas. She was the youngest of two girls, herself and her older sister, Muriel. As a child, Amelia was never at a loss for something to do.
She was action-loving, curious, imaginative, and ever eager to try new things. Later in her senior years of high school, Amelia became unsatisfied with her life. She had few friends and felt left out. She didn't know what she wanted from life. Her parents enrolled her in many different schools, hoping to help Amelia find what she was looking for. During World War I, she thought she had found what she wanted to do. After seeing all the wounded men, she became interested in medicine. Amelia became a nurse's aide at Spadina Military Hospital. Her hours were long, but she worked hard. During her two-hour breaks throughout the day, she would go down to the nearby flying field and watch the officers train and watch airplanes taking off and landing. Machines fascinated her. She never got tired of watching them. She continued her career in medicine, but also took courses in machine and engine repairs. After her first year at Columbia University, she went out to visit her parents in California. Here, she became more and more interested in aviation. Her first experience in a plane was the only experience she needed to know flying was for her. She signed up for lessons soon after that. Amelia spent all her time flying and working to pay for the lessons. Amelia got her NAA pilot's license in May 1923. At that time, flying was just for fun. She then applied for a job at Denison House as a social worker. Her main work was to teach foreign-born adults to read and write English. She worked there for 2 years between 1926 to 1928. Her first proposition of an aviation expedition was proposed by Captain H.H. Raley. On this expedition, she met her husband, George Palmer Putnam, who was also involved with the Atlantic flight. Amelia was thrilled to have been accepted. She thought of herself as the luckiest girl in the world. Amelia wasn't being paid compensation like the others, but didn't care. Lou Gordon, the mechanic, was to receive $5,000, and Bill Schultz, the pilot, was to receive $20,000. The plane, the Friendship, took off on June 5, 1928. It had been the third try to get the plane up. Weather was unfavorable the first two tries. The 13-day trip was nerve-wracking for Amelia. She used up her time by studying charts and maps, also by writing in her logbook about incidents which happened. This logbook became her first novel. Some examples of the contents are these. They landed in Wales after crossing the Atlantic on June 18, 1928. After her Atlantic flight, she attempted many other expeditions, but the Friendship flight was the one that started Amelia's famousness. Amelia tried many other feats and succeeded in all. Her last flight ended suddenly and sooner than anyone expected. During her world flight, Amelia's plane went down for no apparent reason. The Coast Guard, Navy, and anyone that could helped to find the missing plane and Miss Earhart, but there was no such luck. Even to this day, no one has found any evidence to what happened, nor have they come up with a reasonable explanation. This may very well be one of life's mysteries never to be solved.
Center as far back as 1957. In 1957, the Soviets sent up a satellite. It was called the Sputnik. 4 years later, the Soviets also sent a man into space. His name was Yuri Gagarin. From 1961 to 1969, both the Americans and Russians sent different people into space. They sent up a woman and different men. But in 1969, the Americans sent a man up on the moon. His name was Neil Armstrong, and he planted an American flag proudly. After a successful land on the moon, the Americans decided to explore Mars in 1971. Many pictures were taken, and scientists got a very precise idea on how its shape and crust formation is. Later, in 1975, the Soviets and the Americans teamed up to go up into space in the Soyuz Apollo mission. In 1977, the Americans launched the Voyager 1 and 2 to explore other planets. The Voyager 1 took photos of Jupiter and Jupiter's moons. It also took pictures of Saturn. The Voyager 2 took photos of 8 of the 17 moons of Saturn. From 1981 to the present, the Americans have taken many space shuttle flights into space. Many space shuttle flights have succeeded up until the recent explosion of the space shuttle at Kennedy Space Center.
Rowing, one of the oldest sports as well as being one of the oldest methods of transportation. Competitive rowing became popular in Canada during the 1860s. The first recorded regatta in Canada was held on Toronto Bay in 1848. Money prizes were offered for all the events. Shell rowing was introduced in Canada in 1868 by Dick Tinning. Dick and Thomas Loudon were the first oarsmen in Canada to use sliding seats. The seat slides on greased runners. Club hoses were used to hold boats and hold meetings at which weekly regattas were organized. The coxswain in the stern of the boat steers the shell and directs the rhythmic pace of the rowers. Some different locations of regattas are London, Philadelphia, Montreal, and Welland, as well as the Royal Canadian Henley Course. The Henley is a part of the first Welland Canal constructed between 1824 and 1829. This course is used for the annual Royal Canadian Henley Regatta. Rowing involves a large amount of training and concentration. Some types of rowing are sculling, pairs, doubles, fours, and eights. There is heavyweights and lightweights in each category. No sport requires as much determination, stamina, and quick reactions as rowing. It is a sport of perfection. Nothing less than the rhythm of a crew that is pulling together ever satisfies an oarsman who has once experienced this sensation, which has to be experienced to be believed.
Running is very popular throughout the world. Many people use running strictly as a form of exercise. Enjoying it while staying in shape. There are some, however, who go beyond physical fitness. They are the few fine-tuned individuals who devote tremendous amounts of time to the sport, who train long and hard every day of the year, who train to race and race to train. They are champions. It is these successful champions that are the focus of my discussion. To be a winner, a person must focus all their time and energy into their improvement, and of course must love the run. There are a variety of distances a person may wish to pursue, from the quick, flashy 100-meter dash to the prestigious mile event, and up to the grueling and tiresome 26-mile, 385-yard marathon. As we approach the Olympics, which will be held in Seoul, South Korea, in September of this year, the running world will be on their toes to see just who are the fastest men on Earth. Being at what may feel to be a near impossibility, the runners, both men and women, are working day in and day out to be in tip-top shape in 88. The intense training done by these athletes is incredible. In fact, the average male marathon Olympian covers about 180 miles per week in training. That's about 25 to 30 miles a day just to prepare for this race, which is just over 2 hours in length. Leading the pack, two runners stand out in front. Japan's Toshiko Seiko and Kenya's Ibrahim Hussein, who are likely medal contenders this summer in Seoul. Ironically, these are the past two Boston Marathon winners. Seiko destroyed the field in 1987, while Hussein sprinted his final 100 meters to become the 1988 champion. Both are in great shape and will be tough to beat at the Olympics. While describing the medal chances, the likely must be used because anything can happen over the 26-mile, 385 yards. Among many enduring track events, the mile is the most famous. Since Roger Bannister's record-breaking sub-4-minute performance, runners have always tried to be better. Today, although we may see it be broken, the world record for the 1600-meter dash is labeled as 3 minutes 46.31 seconds, set by Steve Cram of Britain. Cram is still going strong today, and we are a strong candidate for a medal in Seoul. His fellow countryman Sebastian Cole, who has held world records from the 800 meters up to the mile 11 times, is also running well, and we can see the Union Jack held doubly high in this race. Other milers who wish to upset Cram and Cole were Said Huita from Morocco, and America's hopeful Sydney Marie. As they dash down the straightaway, the fans go wild. It is the grand finale of every track meet, and usually the highlight of the day. This is the world of sprinting, a tremendously tight finishing and intense form of competition, and certainly one of the most exciting. Today's top sprinters are perhaps some of the most popular people in the world, as children near and far wish for the day they can be a great sprinter. Speaking of great sprinters, there's a fierce battle for the right to the title, the fastest man on Earth. Fortunately, Canada has developed one of these people. First, the other has made history books the last Summer Olympics in 1984 at Los Angeles by duplicating Jesse Owens' feat of winning 4 gold medals. It was at this meet that, in front of a home crowd, Carl Lewis captured not only the 100 and 200 meter victories, but won the long jump and anchored the state's winning 400 meter relay team. Amazingly as it seems, Lewis wants more, and he knows that Seoul's where to get it. Unfortunately for Lewis, but fortunately for Canada, there is one man in his way. A 5'10", 176 pounds Jamaican-born thoroughbred, who immigrated to Canada and by hard work and determination has won nearly every award available to him. He is the one and only Ben Johnson. Big Ben made his claim to fame on August 31st, 1987 in Rome, Italy at the World Track and Field Championships. After several days of fierce competition, the crowd gazed in awe as Johnson humbled Lewis and chopped a tenth of a second off the world record in a stunning 9.83 seconds. Since then, Ben has increased his training regimen in hope of the ultimate dream, an Olympic gold medal. He also states that another record is not out of reach, and that if that's what it takes to be the fastest man on Earth, Big Ben is ready. Let's hope Big Ben represents Canada well, cheering him the victory. After the Olympics, especially if he wins, he will go back to a normal lifestyle of a super sprinter, advertising and fundraising. This multi-millionaire also represents a Japanese oil and gas company, Visa Card, Johnson's Wax, and Mazda, along with the Canadian supermarket chain, an air courier, a vitamin supplement company, and Johnson's Elford Motor, as well as the company that sponsors them. So you can see that the sport of running, hard work pays off. Getting to the top takes hours of determination, effort, and practice. There is also the millions of people who enjoy running for what it really is. An enjoyable, relaxing, social activity that keeps your waist slim in the process. It is one of North America's most popular pastimes, and to many out there, it is an obsession.
Just one more.
They sleep in doorways and panhandle to buy their next meal. Because sleeping in a doorway means you don't have to lie down. That way you can stay half awake and alert, just in case. Over thousands of Canadian families each year face the same dilemma and ask, what can we do? Although the majority of runaways return within 2 days, some find the harshness of street life an acceptable alternative to home and children's aid care. All of these children see running as the answer to their troubles. And until we recognize this fact, there is little hope of bringing them back home.
Yeah.
The year is 1917, a time when the world is at war. The place is Vimy Ridge, an area in which four Canadian divisions would try to successfully capture the ridge. The ridge was first occupied in the early autumn of 1914 by the Germans. The French then tried to regain control in the spring of 1915, but failed miserably, losing 150,000 men. Now it was the Canadians' turn to try to take the ridge. The reason for the urgency for the taking of the ridge was that it threatened the Allies' communication hub of the Arras. If the Allies had possession of the ridge, it would make German continued occupation of the mining city of Linz both costly and difficult, and would also endanger the German hold on the entire southwestern edge of the Douai Plain. The plan to take the ridge was to have four Canadian divisions to attack the ridge at the same time under an artillery barrage. This meant that the Canadian infantry would be walking underneath their own artillery fire, which would be pounding German positions. The 1st Division's objective was to capture Farbes Wood and Bois de la Ville section of the ridge by early afternoon, which was the distance of 4,000 yards. The 2nd Division objective was a belt of woods that ran a mile in the corridor along the base of the ridge on the German side. The 3rd Division, which had a distance of 12,000 yards and had only two objectives, was to reach the red line and to capture the La Folie Wood, to be done in just 2 to 3 hours. The 4th Division, which had the hardest task of all, they had to take the Pimple and Hill 145, two highly fortified parts of the ridge. To make matters worse, not only did the Canadians have to worry about the Germans, but they also had to worry about time. For the plan to work, time was essential. The German held territory was divided by Canadian planners into sections that were to be taken at certain time intervals. These four sections were called the Black Line, the Red Line, Blue Line, and the Brown Line. If any of the lines were not taken at the right time, there would be an indent in the Canadian line, allowing German counterattacks. As well, the Canadian infantry had to keep pace with an artillery barrage, which was to be in front of them. If they failed to do so, they would either be hit by their own artillery or attacked by German soldiers who had not been killed by the shelling. It seemed that with such a complicated plan, as so many obstacles, the Canadians were sure to fail. However, on April 13, 1917, Vimy Ridge was captured by Canadian troops who suffered 11,285 casualties in this battle alone. Not only did success of the battle prove that Canadians were good fighting men, but it also brought Canada together in its time of need. It's no problem.
Honey, I think we should take a taxi. You've had too much.
That's fine.
Bartender, can you call a taxi, please?
Yeah, okay.
I'm glad that couple decided to take a taxi. They could have been killed, or maybe even killed someone else. So the next time you're thinking about drinking and driving, think about life or death.
Yeah. So I guess the bigness of... Yeah, I'm not supposed to talk. Guess I got the mic under my nose.
Quiet in the studio. Ready, camera one?
Ready.
Ready, camera two?
Ready.
Ready, camera three?
Ready.
Ready, audio? Ready, switcher?
Ready.
Ready, VCR? Stand by in the studio. Roll VCR. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, cue the actor.
Television arts started at West Park 15 years ago with two simple cameras and a simple switcher. For audio, we had a microphone and a tape recorder. The reason the course was set up was because of the interest on the part of the student and the belief on the part of the teacher that students needed to understand this most powerful medium of communication. The average student graduating from grade 12 has spent 15,000 hours watching television. They have spent more time watching television than in school. The only thing they have done more than watch television in their life is sleep. This course is not set up to make directors or camera people out of students. Some students do, however, use the course as stepping stones to college, universities, and eventually to careers in television. But the course is specifically set up to give students a better understanding of television. By understanding what goes on behind the scenes and by understanding the techniques of television, students will become discriminating viewers. They should know what is good and bad television, as well as when they are being manipulated by the medium. When students first come into the course, they are given an understanding of the equipment and the techniques of television. Following this, students gain an understanding of why and how commercials are made. Then, students write and direct their own commercials. This hands-on, practical approach to television commercials gives the student a good understanding of how commercials are made. The depth of this understanding could not be gained in any other way. Following commercials, we take the same approach to news and documentaries. Television arts is a particularly good course in developing skills. Most important are the basic skills of reading and writing and research. This not only happens with course content and notes on the board, but also for productions. For each student and for each production, an idea has to be developed, researched, and then a script is written. By examining various types of programs and how we communicate, students develop the critical skills of interpretation, evaluation, and analysis. Through this, students become discriminating viewers. Students will develop skills of manual dexterity and motor ability while handling different pieces of equipment, social skills of responsibility and cooperation, as well as skills of self-expression and communication are developed to their fullest. And of course, a student must use their imagination and creative skills in all aspects of the course. Television is the most common and accepted form of mass communication in North America today. This is not an opinion, this is a fact. Television is now introduced into schools. Any language, written or otherwise, has a formal structure with rules and guidelines to allow its users to arrive at a common understanding or to communicate. Television literacy and visual literacy also have form and structure to their language. When one ignores this, one allows the medium, whatever it may be, to control the user instead of the user control the medium. This is why so many people spend so many wasted hours in front of a television or would sooner watch a poor drama as opposed to an informative documentary. Television is a language, and as such, needs to be understood. It is possibly the most influential medium of our age, and as such, students should be made aware of its methods, motives, and techniques. The course requires that students bring together academic, motor, and social skills to produce television programs. McLuhan stated, "In today's complex technological society, a child needs three languages, written English, spoken English, and the language of the screen. Courses in television are courses for a new age."
Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart marries Constance Weber. 1784, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart becomes a Freemason. 1791, Mozart composes the Magic Flute. On December 5th of that same year, Mozart dies. 1985, Austrian rock singer Falco records
died, he had composed over 600 works. During the last 15 years of his life, he had composed 50 of the greatest masterpieces of his maturity. Although short-lived, Mozart had a career of almost 30 years behind him when he died at the young age of 35 years old.
Expeditions have sought without success to locate the Titanic. North Atlantic's unpredictable weather, the enormous depth at which the Titanic lies, and conflicting accounts for her final hours all compounded the problem. The Titanic was, however, finally discovered 73 years after her sinking. In 1985, the famed ship was located at a latitude of 41 degrees north and 45 degrees west. A team of experts consisting in part of Robert D. Ballard of the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, others from the same institution, and Jean-Louis Michel of the Institut Français de Recherche for the expedition, found the Titanic, one of the world's most famous ships. Their reconstruction of what they believed to be the Titanic's final hours consisted of tracing the movement of four ships before, during, and after her sinking. This reconstruction of events was the key to the locating of the missing liner. On April 14, 1912, at 11 p.m., the Titanic steamed westward, approaching a field of icebergs. The Californian, the ship nearest the Titanic, and the one that could have saved all those aboard if its radio transmitter had not been turned off, was halted by the ice and radio's warnings, only to shortly thereafter shut off her radio. At 11:40 p.m., the Titanic hits an iceberg and radios a distress call with her estimated position at the Pink Cross. Just after midnight, both the Titanic and the Californian sees lights on the ship located between them. This ship came to be known as the Mystery Ship. Historians, though intrigued by the ship, have never been able to identify it. Later, the Californian sees the white rockets on the horizon and doesn't realize that this is distress signals. On April 15th, 2:20 a.m., Titanic goes under, with 711 survivors in lifeboats. The liner Carpathia, which had picked up the first distress call 58 miles to the southeast, continues steaming on a northwest course towards the Titanic. 4:10 a.m., Carpathia encounters a drifting lifeboat and begins rescue. Later, the Californian, which has finally turned on her radio, arrives at the Titanic's reported position, along with Mount Temple and other ships. The mystery ship has long ago vanished. The experts concluded from this information, the Titanic must lie north where the Carpathia meets the lifeboats. 73 years later, on June 28, 1985, the Friendship Le Sort begins mowing the area systematically, crossing the 150 square mile target. One with her deep search sonar, she covers 80% of the zone, leaving only 20% for the American ships to search. September 1st, 1985, 1:05 a.m. Video cameras aboard the search vehicle Argo are being dragged beneath the water surface by the American ships, nor pick up the picture of one of the Titanic's huge boilers at a depth of 13,000 feet. three circular furnace doors, shown as the Titanic lies now on the ocean floor, match those in a historic photograph taken from the Titanic's construction. The search ship Argo took many pictures of the remains of the Titanic. The following pictures are taken by Argo Angus on their 35mm cameras. The bow section of the great ship. Two large cranes labeled B and thereafter portion of the ship, forecastle, and some twisted gargoyle is labeled C on the following diagram. The marine encrusted crow's nest, the same one is seen here in the picture of the Titanic taken in 1911. Some wine bottles scattered across the ocean floor, still containing wine. Also found on the ocean floor, a metal platter surrounded by lumps of coal. A set of bed springs whose narrow width suggests that they came from a second or third class. And a chamber pot. Here in an early photograph of the ship's second class smoking room, in a window appears a panel in the door at the far left. Hundreds of yards astern of the Titanic's hull, this same window was discovered, though in some areas of the ship, 1-inch thick steel crumpled like foil, and other such fragile ornaments, such a great survived intact, a great controversy has risen concerning whether the Titanic should remain or should be raised. Some believe that since the marine scavengers long ago disposed of the victims' bodies, the Titanic is more monument than a tomb, and therefore it should be raised. Others feel like Robert Ballard of the Ocean Hole Oceanographic Institute. It's a quite a peaceful place, a fitting place for the remains of the great of sea tragedies to rest, forever may it remain that way. Like Ballard, Miss Eva Hart, shown here with fellow Titanic survivor, believes the Titanic should be left intact as a memorial to those who went down with her. Miss Hart, who was 7 at the time of the sinking, lost her father, but rowed to safety in a lifeboat along with her mother. She recalls that her mother refused to go to bed at night aboard the Titanic because she had this premonition based on the fact that she declared a vessel unsinkable and was flying through the face of God. Of Titanic's final moments, she says simply, "I saw that ship sink, I saw all the horror of it sinking, and I heard even more dreadful the cries of drowning people."
William Shakespeare is regarded as the greatest writer of all time. He is compared to no one and never will be because nobody will ever reach his talent for the art of writing. He is in a class by himself, a class of which every writer dreams to be in someday, but will never succeed. Shakespeare was born in Stratford-on-Avon at an uncertain date between April 24th, 1563 and April 23rd, 1564. His father, John Shakespeare, rose high in civic life, becoming alderman in 1565 and later on a bailiff in 1568. Although his birth date is not known, some say it was traditionally celebrated on April 23rd. Shakespeare was baptized in the parish register of Holy Trinity Church on April 23rd, 1564. His mother's name was Mary Arden of Wilmcote, Warwickshire, who came from an ancient family and was the heiress to some land. Shakespeare started his education in the Stratford School. School then was free and the teacher was being paid by the Bureau. This was where it started for him. His education would consist of mostly Latin studies, learning to read, write, and also speak the language quite well. He also studied classical historians, moralists, and poets. Shakespeare never attended university, and as a result, was married at the age of 18. He married Anne Hathaway on November 28, 1582. The next date of importance is recorded on May 26, 1583. When Susanna Shakespeare was baptized. Then, on February 22nd, 1585, twins were baptized, Hamnet and Judith. Shakespeare's actions in the next 8 years are not known, but some say he stole deer and got into trouble with Sir Thomas Lucy of Charlecote. Others say he became a school teacher. Some others say he went to London and gained entry into the world of theater by minding the horses. After some prosperous years for Shakespeare, there is evidence that he bought a large house called New Place in 1597. It is not really known how Shakespeare's career in the theater began, but from about 1594 and on, he was a member of Lord Chamberlain's company, along with Richard Burbage. Shakespeare then formed his own theater, where he became a full-time professional man. From the next 20 years on, he devoted himself to writing. He wrote more than a million words of poetic drama of high quality. Shakespeare wrote poems, dramas, and comedies, but he is best known for his dramas, like Romeo and Juliet and Hamlet. From these dramas, many cliches have come, such as Frailty, Thy Nameless Woman. Some may ask, what is special about Shakespeare's writing? The special thing that makes his writing so unique is his play with words, which is demonstrated in Act 1, Scene 2 of Hamlet. In this scene, Hamlet is mourning over his father's recent death. Now, just after his father's death, Hamlet's mother marries his uncle rather quickly.
I do beseech you give him leave to go. Set thy fair hour, Laertes. Time divine, and thy best grace is spent as thou wilt. But now, my cousin Hamlet and my son, a little more than kin and less than kind.
How is it that the clouds still hang on you?
Lord, sir, my lord, I am too much of the sun.
Good Hamlet, cast thy nighted color off, and let thine eye look like a friend on Denmark. Do not forever with thy veiled lid seek for thy noble father in the dust. Thou knowest 'tis common, all that live must die, passing through nature to eternity.
It is common.
In this short scene, Shakespeare played on words three times. The first is spoken by Hamlet when he says, a little more than kin and less than kind. What Hamlet is really saying is that he's closer to his uncle than he would like. Even being a relative to the king is too much for him. The second play on words is when Hamlet again says, not so, my lord, I am too much in the sun. Now, this is a contrast. He is mourning over the death of his father and is compared to a cloud, dark and gray. You may think he feels this happy atmosphere surrounding him makes him feel worse. But the meaning intended by Shakespeare is that he doesn't want to be the king's son, not that the happiness around him is too bright. The third play in words is when he says, ah, madame, 'tis common. His mother is saying that death is common, but Hamlet is really criticizing her. It is not common for a lady to marry so quickly after her husband's death, and it is even more uncommon for her to marry her husband's brother. Shakespeare's plays have become more popular now in schools than ever before. If Shakespeare were alive today, he would be a very proud man. Unfortunately, he died on April 23rd, 1616. Some say he died of heavy drinking one night with two friends. Shakespeare, a man, a poet, and an asset to the human species.
Sad and painful truth about child abuse. Sexual abuse, child beating, and neglect are crimes in all provinces. Some acts may earn the offender a fine and several months in jail. If the child is raped, the offender could serve a very long jail term.
Sexual abuse, beatings, and neglect all share the same problem. It's a crime that goes unreported too much of the time. So often, in fact, that authorities call it the silent crime. The reason for the child's silence is because they're too afraid or too young. They feel threatened, possibly by whoever is doing this to them, or just totally alone. It's long been believed that girls are more often sexually abused than boys. Studies show the girls are the victims 10 times more often, and that the average of the victim is 11 years old.
Children far, far younger have been accosted. Some have just been a few months old. There was a recent case in Welland. A father of a 6-week-old baby plead guilty to her murder. The baby died of head injuries when he beat her and threw her into a box. He also admitted that he sexually abused the 4.5-kilogram child.
Many people think that these children are attacked by weirdos who lurk in the park or strangers who drive up in cars. But in 1967, a study by the American Humane Association proved the exact opposite to be true. Only 1/4 of all sexual abuse is committed by strangers. A scant 2% take place in a car, and 5% take place in abandoned buildings. But in 75% of all cases, the victim knows the assailant, either a neighbor, brother, uncle, grandfather, or stepfather, but most often the father. This type of abuse is called incest.
Another form of abuse, though no molestation is involved, or not in all cases, is physical abuse. The child or teen is beaten to near death. In one case, a 4-year-old girl and 12-year-old sister were found at their home in terrible condition after the neighbors suspected something and called the police. The 4-year-old had a hole in her lip, one toe missing, and there were numerous scars all over her body. She had cuts so deep, the bones were showing.
The 12-year-old sister was hurt just as badly. She had part of 1 ear missing, a broken arm that had never been set, and scars on her hands, back, and neck.
The officers concluded that the sisters had been beaten time and time again by their stepfather, using belt and shovel. What happened to the two sisters is horrifying, though not the sort of thing that happens to the lucky majority of children. But it does happen to many youngsters. Far, far too many. According to social agencies, the beating of children have been multiplying over the past 20 years. These beatings go far beyond what anyone could ever call a swat across the rear or spanking. There are beatings that have cruelly injured the victims, sometimes for life, even ended in death.
Doctors believe child abuse has become an epidemic. The victims even have a special name. They're known as battered children. We don't know the exact number of battered youngsters because most go unreported. It's estimated less than 50% are ever reported to the proper authorities. The death toll makes abuse the number 5 killer of children in the U.S., but some doctors think that child abuse may soon pass some of the above killers.
Many battered children must endure a second terrible problem, neglect. There was a case in Baltimore where the police went to a 9-year-old Betty's home on a tip. There they found her in a closed closet, scarred from many beatings. The girl had been kept there for half her life while her parents ignored her as they went on about their daily business. She was covered with filth and weighed only 23 pounds.
Even if we don't know how many children are battered, we know how. The attacks are brutal and the weapons are frightening. The two sisters, as you remember, were hit with a belt and shovel. Some have been whipped with chains, ropes, electric cords, leather straps, or canes. Some have been clubbed with baseball bats, wooden sticks, or broom handles, and others have had scalding water or coffee poured over them. This is only half. There have been incidents of a child being thrown against the wall or down flights of stairs. Others have been shaken until they suffered brain damage or a form of whiplash.
Some have had their hands held down on hot stove or against steaming pipes. One little girl was made to sit on a radiator and is punished whenever she wet herself.
Do you want to change? If your child is a victim, which may most often be a girl, help her. Don't ignore and expect it to go away. Even though you may hate the idea, the police should be called to prevent the assailant from possibly hurting others. Tell your child what you're doing, then soothe their fears as much as possible. Help the child tell the story and insist that the officers treat her gently. Try not to let the officers question her too long at a time.
Then throughout what may come later, give the child your support and love. Finally, when everything is behind the child, do all that you can to help her forget the incident and try to return a normal, happy life.
Born in 1933, when a man named Adolf Hitler became German Chancellor. Before Hitler came to power, he was in charge of the Nazi Party. He was jailed for trying to take over Bavaria. He wrote a book, Mein Kampf, or My Struggle, which told how he would take over the world. Had more people read this, World War II might not have been fought. Hitler came to power in 1933. He planned to rebuild Germany. He saw Germans as the superior race. He introduced the Luftwaffe in 1937. He also rebuilt the land forces. He disliked the 1918 Treaty of Versailles. Hitler rebuilt the Kriegsmarine, or German Navy. Hitler annexed several countries. His closest ally was Italy, ruled by Benito Mussolini. Hitler signed a peace pact with the USSR. He made laws against the Jewish. He placed many in concentration camps. He placed Hermann Göring and Joseph Goebbels in charge of the SS to arrest the Jewish. On September 1st, 1939, the German army attacked Poland using blitzkrieg or lightning war, using tanks and planes. Polish cavalry to no avail charged to their deaths against the German tanks. Hitler signed a peace pact with the USSR, and on September 17th, Russia invaded Poland. Germany next attacked Norway and Denmark in April 1940. The British tried to aid against Germany, but were beaten. The French and English dug in behind the Maginot Line and the Germans behind the Siegfried Line. This caused the phony war. Germany next attacked Holland, Belgium, and Luxembourg. They attacked France using the same manner as in World War I by going through Belgium in May 1942. They attacked France in June of 1940. France fell June 14, 1940 when Paris was captured. They forced the French and English back to the Channel. Next, Hitler sent the Luftwaffe to bomb Britain. Then the RAF counterattacked. This was known as Battle of Britain, but the Allies won. In the spring of 1941, Germany invaded Yugoslavia, Greece, and Crete. On June 21, 1941, Germany turned on Russia. They came close to Moscow. Government and factories were moved to Siberia. When the fierce Russian winter hit, the Germans were unprepared. Then from the rear, fresh Russian shock troops came in. These men could fight in 30 below zero temperatures. The German army was pushed back to the border of Russia and into Western Europe. In 1941, Russia was recognized as an ally to England, US, Canada, and France. In 1942, the Third Reich was victorious even in North Africa. The Italian army was beaten so many times that Hitler sent in Field Marshal General Erwin Rommel, shown here. The end came for Germany's North Africa campaign, May 7, 1943. Hitler recalled Rommel and the Allies won the battle. A quarter of a million Germans and Italian troops were captured. September 14, 1942, Germany captures Stalingrad in the USSR. December 3, 1942, Russians retake Stalingrad. On January 5, 1943, Germany retreats back to Germany. July 10, 1943, Allies invade Sicily unopposed. August 11th, 1943, U.S. bombs Romanian oil field. January 22nd, 1944, the beginning of the end as the Anzio campaign begins as the Allies attack Italy. Russians within 80 miles of Romania, USSR retakes Sevastok. June 4th, Allies enter Rome. June 6th, 1944, D-Day begins. This was more successful than the Dieppe raid. Germany surrenders Paris August 25th. August 24th, Russia takes Czechoslovakia and threatens Hungary. October 2nd, U.S. attacks Siegfried Line. December 16th to December 30th, Battle of Bulge, Germany loses. Russians within 10 miles of Oden River, January 22nd, 1945. March 7th, U.S. crosses Rhine River. April 11th, Allies 80 miles from Berlin. Next day, President Roosevelt dies. April 28th, Mussolini executed by Italian partisans. May 1st, 1945, Hitler kills his friend, his family, his wife, and then kills himself. May 7th, Germany surrenders. After this, SS officers are arrested and tried. Many escaped and are still at large today.
Take a minute. Keep going.